The 60s and 70s were a time of rebellion, even on the small screen. The Mod Squad won 5 Emmys and heaps of Logie Awards as the TV show captured the changing times. Now, its lead actor, Michael Cole, spoke with our very own Craig Bennett about his battle with addiction, as well as near-death experiences and being responsible for one of Australian TV's most shocking moments.
They were the groovy gang of crime fighters who busted the bad guys and broke down the barriers. The Mod Squad featured the hippie and free-loving Julie, played by Peggy Lipton, the freedom-fighting Link, played by Clarence Williams III, and TV's quintessential rebel, Pete Cochran, channeled by the hunky Michael Cole. 3 undercover cops who are still loved over 4 decades on.
Let's go to Julie's house and get something to eat. She wanted to know how it went anyway.
Ooh, you're a devious cat.
I'm still surprised. Do you know that there's still fan clubs out there? And I think there's some people in Australia. And, you know, there's not many people from Madison, Wisconsin that get to fly to Australia. And I just have always considered myself lucky.
But with the dizzy heights of fame came a burden. Despite an amazing natural talent, Michael was crippled with insecurities and had lacked self-confidence from a young age. This led him to a long-time battle with the bottle, and those booze binges almost cost him everything.
So do you think, Michael, that's why you started drinking at 12 years of age, because it gave you that bravado, that strength?
I think it had a lot to do with it. But if I would have said anything then, it would have been an excuse. I mean, I was put in jail. I was like 15 or 14 or something like that.
What were you in jail for?
I passed out in the gutter. We were going to have to move. Everything went black. So the next few days or whatever it was, I got an orange jumpsuit on that says Dane County Jail on the back.
In 1968, Michael's life would change forever. TV tycoon Aaron Spelling auditioned him for a starring role in The Mod Squad. It was a surreal time for Michael, who had literally gone from being on the breadline.
Is it true, Michael, when you made the move to come to Hollywood, looking obviously for a start as an actor, times were so tough, you were living under freeways?
Yes, but at that time, when you're that broke, you don't know that it's tough, because you're too busy trying to survive.
To the toast of Tinseltown.
One of the first week or something like that, when we were doing the pilot, and it looked up and here's this huge, massive picture of the Mod Squad on top of the Paramount building. And I was, whoa! And I walked a couple blocks further and said, Michael, you got this picture on Paramount Studios. And that's where you were sleeping a year ago.
Under the bridge.
Under the freeway, right. Under the bridge. I still didn't get it.
You are a superstar around the world, and you're involved in a near-fatal car crash.
Wow.
You went through the windscreen.
Twice. The stop went back, and then it hit again. And there's like 130 stitches all up here. Got to the hospital, I thought, oh, well, so much for acting, unless you want to play Quasimodo.
You were fearing your career would be over, of course.
Pretty much so.
But work he did, and he finally got sober. Michael has been proudly on the wagon for over 20 years, something he details in his scorchingly candid new memoir, and it's thanks to his third wife, Shelley, who literally saved his life.
Shelley gave me an ultimatum. When I came home once, Shelley was sitting there with the guy and with a couple other people from Alcoholics Anonymous.
So this was an intervention?
Exactly.
To save your life?
Sure did. I looked at Shelley. And Shelley was crying, and she said, I can't take it. We called Betty Ford, and I was down there right after Christmas. And that was it. So she did save my life.
Did she give you an ultimatum and say, basically, Michael, it's me or the bottle?
Yeah. Absolutely.
You made the right decision, didn't you?
Oh, I would not be sitting here.
Australia holds a special place in Michael's heart, and we have a special spot for him too, thanks to that infamous appearance at the 1973 Logie Awards. A rather tired and emotional Michael Cole stunned the nation when he swore on a live telecast, a moment that has lived on in Logie's infamy.
Oh,
congratulations, Michael.
That moment sent shockwaves around the country and was front page news. And now, 45 years on, Michael reveals what really happened.
I didn't know that they were that touchy. They gave me another Logie. I thought I was done on stage.
Because you're on a roll that night, weren't you?
Yeah.
Getting Logie after Logie
yes,
after Logie.
Yes, absolutely. And I was like, whoa, I don't have to go up there again. And so I was sitting with Glenn Ford, wonderful, wonderful actor. And anyway, they called, Michael, we have a special award for you. It's from the people that want to say how much you mean to, et cetera, et cetera. And I just looked out at the Aussie people and I loved them so much and respect. And I just said, oh, shit. the curtain came down, the lights went off.
Everyone went into a meltdown about it.
Yeah, but when I was leaving, people in the streets were screaming, Michael, we thought you were great. We thought you were great, mate. That kind of stuff, so that lifted me.
He has experienced the lowest of lows and the highest of highs. And as someone who's lived such a tumultuous life, he's not taking any of it for granted. Michael Cole, I've read your book. I got to say, it's an absolute rip snorter. I don't know what it was like to be so honest to lay your life bare, but it is, as I see it, a must read.
Thank you, Dad. It was beautiful. You really got me, really touched me with that. That means so much coming from an Aussie. To me, I see you got me.
I know you're lost for words. Thank you, Michael. Lovely to see you again.
God bless.